No camera is perfect, it's okay. We love the S5, but there are a few repeated issues we've all heard about or experienced firsthand. Some issues include the S5 only has an L mount, the micro HDMI port is sometimes annoying, the autofocus isn't as fast as Sony or Canon. We'll discuss these and more, so let's jump in and see what to do about them. Number one, let's start with an easy one, the articulating screen. Some people don't like the articulating screen, partially because it can bump into the cables plugged into the ports on the left side of the camera if you want to flip it to another orientation. The mic cable is clear, but all the rest of the ports are in the way. Option one, don't pivot the screen 180 degrees outward before rotating. Rotate out 90, then rotate to preference, then rotate in or out. This goes for any camera in a similar situation like my Canon M50. Option 2. How about using a flat cable to get the mobility back? Okay, it actually doesn't work, but I wanted to share my results just in case you were considering it. Option 3. Ignore your screen and use an external monitor either attached to the camera or on a tripod. I personally love option 3 and use it the most often since I love the bigger screen to more easily see that I'm in focus. The Anisine 4K is extremely light and doesn't bog down the weight of the camera too much, and since most of my controls are on the buttons, I don't need to access the touchscreen that often. If you're curious about my settings, check out the video Best Settings for Video for the S5 up here. Number 2. No All-Eye Recording Option. I'm going to try to avoid going into a huge video codec conversation, but I will at least define some basics to better understand the question. All-Eye stands for intra-frame and requires massive write speeds, upwards to 600 megabytes per second and more in many cases. The more information, the better the image, right? And then there's long GOP, or long group of pictures, which is what codec the S5 films in. Long GOP is an IPB codec, which just stands for predictive and bidirectional frames, which is called interframe, not intraframe like all eye. So you have intraframe and interframe. Okay, now that we have some boring nomenclature down, the big difference is that all eye or intraframe records all of the pixels for every single picture, while long GOP cheats and only records between the full frames of what changed. So if your background is not moving like here, and I'm the only thing moving, then long GOP or interframe will only record the differences of me per the frame and not the pixels in the background that are not changing between a set of intraframe or full pictures. Final thoughts before moving on is that there seems to be three claims why all eye is better versus long GOP. Better resolution, better for color grading, and better for editing. They say long GOP will use a lot of extra processing power for decompression per frame if you're splicing the footage. I like Sam Holland's side-by-side comparison, and I'm on his side of not seeing a big enough difference to worry about it other than a potentially added sharpness, but there are some great options that I'll share in a moment. Make sure to watch Sam's video in the description for his results. I won't go over any more on the codec details other than to say that this is really an in-camera versus out-of-camera body question to me, since the S5 does not have all-eye anyways. So what magical options do we have available for the S5 besides long GOP? If we look for out-of-camera body options like external recorders? How about option number one, the Blackmagic Video Assist, which provides three all-eye intraframe variants called BRAW, ProRes, or DNX. Option number two is the Atmos Ninja 5. I chose the Blackmagic Video Assist because I wanted BRAW since I use a 6K Pro and DaVinci Resolve, but the Atmos Ninja 5 is also a great option if you want to record in True RAW to ProRes or DNX. BRAW opens the door to 12-bit color, which is a crazy amount of colors. The primary advantage of having more colors available in the file is to push for color grading in order to push the image in post, not what we can technically see since we can only see about a million colors, because 12-bit captures up to about 68 billion colors. Internally, the S5 can currently film 200 megabits per second in long GOP at 10-bit, which has one major advantage over all-eye. You don't need super expensive SD cards. And if you choose to use an external monitor as well, then you gain another advantage. which is the ability to record to external SSD drives, which are much cheaper for memory than SD cards. I'll be honest, for most of my projects, Long GOP works completely fine recording to an SD card in the S5 camera body, and I don't need heavier codecs for everything, but it is so convenient to use BRAW in 5.9K for my short film workflow using the Blackmagic Video Assist. Number 3, L-mount. Some have mentioned their issues with the S5 is limited amount of lenses for the L-mount. There are some great lens options for L-mount today and more coming for sure, but there are a few great adapters to help fix this issue. Since I started by shooting on the 6K Pro, I have a lot of EF lenses, so I purchased two adapters to help share the lenses. They work perfectly for me. Option number one. I started with the $35 Earth EF to L-mount adapter with my manual lenses and it worked great. Option number two. I later added the Sigma MC21 for the lenses where I needed control of the aperture, like the IRIX lenses, or when I wanted to use the focus control like the Sigma 18-35. There is one negative here though, the continuous autofocus or AFC mode does not work with this adapter yet. We are still waiting for an update from Sigma to hopefully enable it. I tried the Sigma 18-35, the Canon Nifty 50, the EFS 55-250, and none of them worked in AFC mode. A link to the Sigma MC21 and a chart with some of the lenses and their enabled capabilities is in the description. Option 3. The Metabones EF to L-mount adapter. Oh wait, this doesn't exist yet. The Metabones EF to MFT mount works with the Lumix cameras for AFC, but we're sadly left without a direct answer here. At least I haven't seen one yet. Definitely let me know if you have an answer for AFC mode for the EF lenses. Option 4. Just buy the native lenses. Having native lenses can sometimes help with options like AFC or possibly faster autofocus, but in general, this isn't an issue I've personally run into. I don't use continuous autofocus, but that doesn't mean you won't. Let me know if you've experienced any issues with the adapters or any particular lens with the S5 in the comments below. Number 4, the micro HDMI port. I hope that Panasonic learns their lesson here and provides a full-size HDMI on all their cameras moving forward, but is there anything we can do about it today, and what are the real risks with the micro HDMI port anyways? My first curiosity led me to verify the required type of HDMI cable for best results with the S5. Reading through the S5 manual and the Blackmagic Video Assist manual for HDMI requirements, they define to use a high-speed HDMI micro cable on page 290 in the S5 manual. This is a typical term, but I'm a little surprised that the camera manufacturers don't use HDMI revision numbers yet instead. So this seems to be 10 gigabytes per second or HDMI 1.4 when the micro connector type D was added to the HDMI family. The industry seems to just use different logos for people to recognize which type they have, but this seems a little messy. Provide us numbers, please. Are they just going to keep adding adjectives? The ultra, premium, 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 ultra cable? Instead of just saying HDMI 2.2? Okay, what about the risks? I couldn't find any long-term testing results about the connector. That might define something like minimum or maximum tested life cycles. In aviation, our components are tested until they fail, so we know their mean time between failure, MTBF. I just want to pull in some best practices from that world to see if we can apply them here to better understand this question about the Type D HDMI connector. I won't share my notes walking through a FAMIA failure mode and effects analysis, but just share the most common risks identified as probable. Some of the risk factors identified. Number 1, cable tilt. The Type D cable can more easily tilt up or down, losing connection inside of the connector. It is about 500% smaller, using about 75% less in length than the Type A HDMI cable, which is the one we all love. Number 2, installation and removal cycles. The Type D cable has much smaller pins, which might reduce total cycle times until the cable pins wear out, bend, or break after plugging in and unplugging so many times. Number 3, handling for installation. The more gentle you handle plugging in the connector, the better. Never force it. If you feel resistance, remove the connector and visually inspect the camera and the connector if you have any doubts. Number 4, handling for storage. I never saw anyone identify if the cable connector broke or if the cable itself just stopped working, because it could be the wiring inside of the cable breaking from repeated twisting, possible even stretching or damaging the cable by stepping on it or smashing between two hard objects on accident. There are a million ways wires can be damaged, of course. Just make sure to carefully coil and store your cables and they will last much longer. Number 5, quality of the cable. You get what you pay for most times. Just make sure to have extra cables for more sensitive items like this when you're on set to avoid a run to Best Buy. Now that we identified a few risk factors, let's walk through a few options. Option number one, use a mini HDMI to type A HDMI cable. I don't like this option because I'm always stuck removing the cable and there's nothing to help holding the cable in place while shooting. Option number two, use a mini HDMI to HDMI type A cable, but clamp it to the frame somehow. This will help with keeping the cable reliably plugged in, but you'll have to unplug it every time. Option three, use a cage with a mounted micro HDMI to HDMI type A port. This allows the port to remain plugged in, reducing installation cycles. This will also help hold the cable into the port, removing the cable tilt issue. This allows you to use existing HDMI cables and swap out lengths if needed. And if the cable breaks, it can be replaced, saving wear and tear on the micro HDMI port on the S5. It's very cheap, around $11 on Amazon. The handle I used here is only about $30 and is also made by SmallRig. I honestly use option three most of the time. A few final caveats. There's one danger to leaving your cable plugged in all the time, which is you might have a higher likelihood of bumping it on accident unless you have a cage blocking the ability to hit the cable. And the long-term load on the cable being torqued like I have it might cause some issues for the wiring, but so far it works great for me. Number five, autofocus. You probably thought I wasn't going to address this one. After all, what can you do about it? Everyone compares the S5 to Sony and Canon cameras, then conveniently forgets to leave out the price differences for the cameras they are comparing them to. The A7S III is $2,000 more and the R6 is almost $1,000 more than the S5. Option one, continuous autofocus settings. There are settings that work in most situations. Here are my settings. Okay, for setup, make sure to use a native lens and use a brightly lit subject. For settings, select AFC for continuous autofocus. Select tracking. Then update your speed and sensitivity settings. Now for operation, with your subject in view, select it until you get an orange box. Okay, this is looking for a font. Really can't follow the white very well. So it's tracking the font. I'm gonna come in. That might be too close for the lens. And I'm gonna push out. A quick note for AFS mode. The L-glass Canon lenses were a touch more responsive than the EFS lenses since they use a faster USM motor versus the STM motor. Option two. There's one more option available beyond autofocus for a lot of situations, so depending on what you're filming, you don't actually need autofocus. I know it isn't directly addressing autofocus, not being as good as Sony or Canon, but I still think it should be addressed. The answer? Depth of field. You can create a great depth of field vlogging or for your typical talking head YouTube videos like this without even using any autofocus at all. Depending on the lighting available and the sensor size of your camera, the settings will change quite a bit. But for this example, use the S5 and share the lighting as I go. I'm going to manual mode, an f-stop of F8. Focus to the gray card where my face would typically be. Adjust light as needed for exposure, and I'm done. Oh, and then lower the microphone in place just out of view. For quick reference of settings, let's use this handy chart and see what's in focus from f1.8 to f22 to help make sense of the depth of field using the same distance and adjusting the f-stop. If you want to understand more about the depth of field, then watch Gerald and Dunn's video and a very short video by PhotoPills explaining a little more on the application side. Both videos are in the description. Bonus round! Number six, Lack of manual focus to autofocus mode. A lot of people have issue with the barrel switch on the back of the S5, not wanting to rotate it in the middle of shooting. I don't blame you, and there's a workaround. With the lens switch set to manual, you can still apply autofocus by pressing and holding the rear AF on button to activate autofocus, even though the camera is in manual mode and MF mode on the lens. This only seems to work with the native L-mount lenses so far, but super convenient if you need to focus really quickly between manually focusing. No matter the amount of issues or shortcomings of the S5, they all fall short compared to the crazy amount of advantages this camera has for the price, which is still around $1,700 right now. And regardless of what camera you're using or how you're working through your workflow, the story matters the most. These are just tools in the end to support your vision, and sometimes when the tools provide a challenge, it can be a good thing for us to use our creativity and find a workaround. I don't mean this to be a cop-out, but just a quick reminder that no camera does everything perfectly. So we need to remain focused on the story or the project and creatively get the perfect shot. Just watch anything by Buster Keaton and be prepared to be blown away by what he has accomplished with such lack of technology back in the day. I hope one of the solutions helps you with your projects if you're using the S5. This was a lot of fun to put together and share. Please let me know any questions or comments below, and I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for joining.